Hey, what's up guys? Will here for GSM Arena. We have here today the Galaxy S21, the vanilla model from Samsung's 2021 flagship lineup. What has changed here, and is the S21 worth getting over the more expensive models or last year's S20? Let's find out in our full review. The Galaxy S21 is a flagship phone with flagship features, though Samsung is doing something a bit different this year. With the S21 series, the gap between the vanilla model and the Ultra one is wider than ever before. You'd expect a difference in the size and the cameras, sure, but the regular S21 comes with a lower res screen than the Ultra, without a curved edge. You don't get fancy stylus support here, and instead of a Gorilla Glass back, you get one made of plastic. Yes, it's true, the S21 is a substantial downgrade from the S21 Ultra, but at the same time it's not nearly as expensive. The plastic back isn't that big of a deal either. While it is kind of a bummer to have on a premium phone, it doesn't feel cheap, and we rather enjoy the phantom violet color and matte finish. Plus, the S21's small size and lightweight make it a nice choice for someone looking for a compact, high-end phone. The way the camera bump curves into the aluminum frame is a nice touch too. It's the S21 series signature look, and is especially striking in this color. And you get full IP68 waterproofing on the S21, as you should expect from a Samsung flagship phone. The S21's dynamic AMOLED display is 6.2 inches, with a small punch hole for the selfie cam, and is protected by Gorilla Glass Victus. It's the same size as last year's, but with a lower 1080p resolution. It's not so different from the S20 though. Both devices feature a 120Hz refresh rate, but on the S20, if you enabled that, its QHD resolution would dial down to 1080p as well. This year, the refresh rate is adaptive, so it will adjust depending on what's on screen. So this way you get that smooth effect while touching the phone and scrolling, but the phone will save energy when it can, going down to as low as 48Hz. Of course, content looks excellent here. Though it isn't QHD, the resolution still seems plenty sharp, and you get deep blacks and vibrant colors, which are adjustable in settings to be extremely accurate. Brightness is excellent too. We measured a maximum of 415 nits with the slider, and a boost up to 850 nits in bright conditions, regardless of whether adaptive brightness is toggled on or not. The S21 makes use of an upgraded ultrasonic under-display fingerprint reader for biometrics and unlocking the phone. It's a bit more responsive than last year, and the scanning area is larger too. The Galaxy S21 also has a pair of stereo speakers for your audio. You get sound from the earpiece under the top frame, as well as from a bottom-facing speaker. We're hearing very clean and pleasing vocals and nice highs, but not that much in the way of bass. If you want to plug in headphones, you won't find a 3.5mm jack here. You'll need to connect wirelessly or use a USB-C dongle. And another thing you won't find on any of the S21 phones is a microSD slot, though you can get 128 or 256 gigs on board the S21. The final major piece missing from the package is a charging adapter. The S21 supports up to 25W charging, but you'd have to buy that separately if you don't have one. With the 25W adapter though, we were able to charge the S21 from 0 to 55% charge in half an hour. Not crazy fast, but decent. An 18W adapter got us to 40% in the same amount of time, in case you have one of these around instead. The phone also supports 10W wireless charging as well as reverse wireless charging if you want to charge up another device with your phone. As far as battery life goes, we were happy with what we were able to get on the S21. The phone has a 4000 mAh battery, the same capacity as last year, but has scored much better in our tests, earning an endurance rating of 93 hours. Now onto the S21's interface. It's Samsung's One UI 3.1 based on Android 11. One UI 3 integrates plenty of features from the new version of Android. You get notification history, which you can access in settings. There are also revamped media controls, where you can easily swap between playback on different apps. Now you can pin apps to the top of the sheet that appears when you want to share something, so sharing things to your favorite apps is easier. And with One UI 3.1, you no longer get a Samsung Daily home screen panel, but the more useful Google Feed. One UI 3.1 also brings some changes to the camera interface over One UI 3. For example, Live Focus mode is now called Portrait mode, and you have Pro mode for the ultrawide camera. Under the hood of the Galaxy S21 is a cutting-edge flagship chipset, either an Exynos 2100 like we have on our unit, or a Snapdragon 888 depending on the market. Both are built on a 5nm process, and are supposed to be quite close performance-wise. However, we were only able to test the Exynos, and we weren't exactly blown away by the results. CPU benchmark scores were in the same ballpark as last year's top Android chip, the Snapdragon 865 Plus. And in graphics tests, performance wasn't exactly chart-topping either. Regardless though, in real-world tasks we had no problems using the S21, and gaming is a breeze, especially with games that support a high frame rate. Plus, you get support for 5G network connectivity too. Let's move on to the Galaxy S21's triple camera setup. On paper, it's pretty much identical to last year's S20. There's a 12-megapixel main camera, a 12-megapixel ultra-wide-angle cam with fixed focus, and a 64-megapixel telephoto camera that provides 3x lossless digital zoom. In good light, 12-megapixel shots from the main cam are quite appealing. They have nicely saturated colors, wide dynamic range, well-controlled noise, and an adequate level of detail. Comparing the output to last year's S20 Plus, you'll notice a difference in processing. The S20 models had warmer, more saturated colors, a trend not only for the main camera, but pretty much across the board. You can take 64 megapixel shots with the S21's telephoto camera at a little more than 1x zoom. These are very detailed, and dynamic range is as good as from the main cam. Contrast is a bit lower though. To achieve its advertised lossless zoom, the phone crops from the center of that 64 megapixels. At 2x zoom, the results are generally good, but a little soft for some reason. 3x zoom adds some upscaling to the mix, which results in less sharpness and contrast, and noise is a bit more visible. These photos are still very usable. According to Samsung, improvements in AI stabilization make taking long zoom shots, like at 30x, easier and with better results. Maybe it is a bit easier, but don't expect great quality from this level of zoom. The Galaxy S21's portrait shots are taken with the telephoto camera by default. The zoom allows for a nice distance between the camera and the subject, and the results are great, with excellent detail and superb edge detection. You can also take a wide portrait with the main camera. This requires getting much closer to the subject, though the results are generally very good. We did notice a few mistakes with stray hair though. We weren't too impressed by the 12-megapixel shots from the ultra-wide-angle cam. While the dynamic range is commendable, the photos often came out rather soft for some reason. It's more apparent if you compare it to the sharper photos that last year's models could come up with. Hopefully, Samsung addresses this through a software update. In low light, the S21's main camera performs well. The exposure isn't too dark, and you have a wide dynamic range and good color saturation. The level of detail is pretty good too. Turning on night mode results in better contained highlights and lifted detail in shadows. The colors look different though, and lights lose some of their warmth. Low light zooming with the telephoto camera doesn't produce nice results. The photos come out mushy and noisy. Night mode does improve things a lot though. You get better detail for both straight edges and textures, and the noise gets cleaned up. Without night mode, the ultra-wide camera's performance at night is nothing impressive. These photos have a dark exposure and are soft and noisy. With night mode on, the image quality is improved a lot, and shadows are brightened considerably. The Galaxy S21 has a 10-megapixel front-facing camera just like last year. But the processing is different now. Facial details are sharper than what we saw on the S20 or S20 Plus, where they were more smoothed out. Plus, now you have a new toggle in settings to choose a natural or bright mode for your selfie. The differences between the two are pretty subtle though. As far as video recording goes, little has changed from last year. We prefer the 4K footage at 30fps from the main camera, rather than 60fps. This is detailed, with pleasing colors and excellent dynamic range. Here's 4K at 60fps for a comparison. There's less detail, excessive sharpening, and more visible noise. 4K footage at 30fps from the ultra-wide-angle cam is really nice, with respectable dynamic range, lifelike colors, and good detail for an ultrawide. 4K zoomed videos from the telephoto cam are good too. At 3x zoom, you'll get a decent level of detail, and while some noise is visible, it's subtle. The 64MP telephoto cam can also be used to shoot video in 8K at 24fps. We're not big fans of it. The footage isn't all that sharp or detailed, and there are some visible compression artifacts as well. Electronic stabilization is available in all modes, including 8K and 4K at 60fps. The EIS generally does a good job in smoothing out your footage, but it achieves the best results on the ultrawide cam. So there you have it, guys. The Samsung Galaxy S21 is a nice compact smartphone that offers a durable and waterproof build, an excellent AMOLED screen with a high refresh rate, stereo speakers, a high-performance chipset, and a solid, if not so innovative, camera experience. You even get great battery life, which is a bit of a surprise from the vanilla model. But like I mentioned earlier, the S21 is missing a lot of things that you would get with the more expensive S21 Ultra. Plus, it's made of plastic, and you don't get a curved screen. It doesn't feel like a next-gen Samsung. In fact, the S21 seems a lot more like last year's S20 FE, which wasn't a top-tier device, but more like a flagship killer. If only the S21 had a lower price to earn that same sort of label. At the end of the day, the S21 does do a lot of things right, but you can find pretty much all of these features, for less money, in last year's S20. And if you wanted something really cutting edge, you'd be better off looking at the S21 Ultra. Thanks for watching, guys. Stay safe, and see you on the next one.